To our first plenary session of the day, which is the experts' debate on affordable housing, a game changer. Well, I'd like to first welcome our moderator for the session, who happens to have more than 27 years of experience in multidisciplinary advisory and transactions ranging from real estate to social development projects. The moderator for the session, ladies and gentlemen, is the chairman of Anarock Property Consultants, Mr. Anuj Puri. Could we have a huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen? Joining him, our first panel member. He comes with a rich experience of around two decades in financial, capital market, and commodity market. He's a co-founder and chairman of Signature Global Group, Pradeep Aggarwal. Yes, you could have that round of applause flowing, ladies and gentlemen, as we also invite the other panelists on stage. Our next panelist happens to be a qualified engineer in computer science, but also spearheads the launches of SARE Homes Residential Projects Plan. He is the managing director for SARE Homes. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Vineet, Relia. All right, we'll move further. Our next panelist is a first-generation entrepreneur who has steered the growth trajectory of Parsvnath Group. He's a founder and chairman of Parsvnath Developers Limited, Pradeep Jain. Our next panelist also happens to be a first-generation entrepreneur, having more than 17 years of experience in construction, real estate, and development, the chairman and managing director for Tulip Infratech, Parveen Jain. We also have with us one of the first to advocate the concept of affordable housing. In fact, he's a chairman and managing director for Omaxe Limited, Rohtas, Goel. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, we have Anushree Srivastava, who's the CEO and co-founder of Zivesta. Ladies and gentlemen, she's also an ex-IRCTC and also winner of National E-Governance Award. Could we have a huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen? Those are our panelists, and let the panel discussion begin.
Thank you very much. I'm not so sure whether this is audible. Should be audible. Okay. Well, I'm actually quite excited. I haven't had this panel discussion with some of the very close friends. Pradeep, I've known for 25 years. Both of us had an office in Connaught Place. I moved to Bombay, and he moved really upwards. So it's interesting to hear his comments, Mr. Aggarwal. It'll be interesting to hear.
All right. That's okay. I'll take this. Don't worry. I haven't met this gentleman for a very long time. And I said to him is that all the difficult questions are going to go to him. He was amongst the first ones who got listed, 2006-7. So it's great. Anushree, I had an opportunity to speak with her on a different subject yesterday. And little did we know that we were going to share a panel today. And then Vineet, obviously somebody who's really delivered huge amount of volumes from a foreign fund. Interesting to know that how SARE converted from a fund into a developer and successfully executing projects in India. So I'm going to quickly set some tone. You know, as Neeraj was giving his presentation, I was writing 10 points that I wanted to share with this audience. You know, the first is what Neeraj said is that there are three tsunamis. So he articulated it very well. Clearly, we've had demonetization, GST, RERA. I said is that perhaps this has been the most challenging year in 25 years of my career. I think is that I have witnessed probably four recessions. I haven't witnessed such a prolonged, slow recovery. We witnessed when the markets went down straight, and within two or three quarters, the markets were back. This time, we've been in it for nearly 2 years, maybe more. And I see this going for another 18, 24 months. So it is a prolonged way to recovery. Second, I said I'm enjoying it thoroughly. Why I'm enjoying it? Because this market will get hugely consolidated. Hugely consolidated, whether it is the developer space, I feel 60-70% of the people are not going to emerge on the other side of this tunnel, which may be in the next 2 or 3 years. And likewise, on the agency, on the brokerage, 60-70% of them are not going to emerge on the other side. So a lot of youngsters who are sitting in here, it is great news, because on the other side of the tunnel, you're going to see a lot more mature, professional, transparent, full of governance market. The third I wrote to myself, the launches that happened in the second quarter of 2017 were the lowest since Lehman crisis. So lowest since Lehman crisis, January to March 2009. This is that time that we are in the quarter, second quarter of this year, which is the June ending quarter, which is interesting that it is so low. The numbers are 22,000. On an average, we've been launching 70,000 units, and we launched only 22,000 units. This is before RERA. This is not after RERA, and hence could be a bit of an impact of RERA, that people were waiting for RERA to get implemented in some of the states. The next is a very positive point, which is interesting. Last six quarters, and you know, it's very, very important to understand, last six quarters, every quarter, sales have been more than the launches. Every quarter, sales have been more than the launches. It doesn't mean that the sales have gone up or the volume has gone up, it's just that the launches have come down. Which is good in a way that the unsold inventory is shrinking, which is great from that perspective. The next one I wrote is that this time the recovery is going to be on sound fundamentals and not transient sentiment. I think in the previous three recoveries that I was reflecting, it was a transient sentiment, nor a sound fundamental. This time when we will emerge, it will be a sound fundamental. I wrote the third last point, consumer activism will increase. And you know, both the gentlemen on my left and right will vouch for this. I think speculator will continue to remain out. We're not going to see speculators coming in a hurry back in here. Which was interesting, the last point that I said is, you know, I was looking at our research data. Interestingly, you know, we beat NCR all the time. And you know, I'm a culprit for that as well. And I was looking that the price rise in NCR and in the three markets that I picked up, Delhi, Gurgaon and Noida, from the previous peak, which was just before the Lehman crisis, the previous peak, what would the index be? So if before the Lehman crisis, all these three markets assumed was 100 index, which was the peak. Delhi went up to 118, Gurgaon went up to 125, and Noida went up to 105. Now you may say, you know, that is significant that from the previous peak you've gone up, but consider that we've been in the cycle for 8 or 9 years. Your inflation is going to be much more than what they have increased. But if you compare this with Mumbai, Thane, and Navi Mumbai, then whilst Delhi increased to 118 from 100, Mumbai increased from 100 to 149. Gurgaon increased from 100 to 125, Thane increased from 100 to 140, Noida increased from 100 to 105, Navi Mumbai increased from 100 to 160. So clearly there are other markets that are creating trouble. Now, and I can go on and on and on, but this is not my opening speech. These are the reflections that I put together so that we can have an interesting panel discussion. And the point is really on affordable housing now. All this is where it is. Can the affordable housing demonstrate that there is a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow? And that is what we're going to discuss. And if there is, what is the key to get to that pot of gold? What is it that the developers need? Is it land? Is it financial incentives? Is it timely clearances? Is it better loans? What is it that is required? So Pradeep, I'm going to start with you with the first question. Your thoughts on the overall market, one. And second, is affordable housing a dream or is it a reality? Two things. One, overall market. And second, is affordable housing a dream or is it really a reality?
See, as you rightly said, the market is worst ever we seen in 25-30 years. In my view, the worst is behind. I'm not agree with you that this continue for another 2 years. The demonetization, RERA, GST, lot of issues come up on the table. And I believe now government do understand the need of the hour to support to this sector. As yesterday you have seen the basket opened by the government, and they are talking about 10 lakh crore rupees investment into the roads, construction, public-private partnership, etc. We are connected directly or indirectly somehow with all those development. But definitely, we all sitting on this side of the table are responsible for that, whatever be happening or happened in last couple of years. We need to be rectified ourselves. We need to be consolidate ourselves. We need to be fair with our consumer. We need to be fair with our regulator. And almost the situation like 15 years ago when the SEBI introduced for the share broker and RERA introduced for real estate developer. Almost the same time of the woman cry at that time as we people are crying today. Going forward, the supply become a big concern, very, very big concern. As you said, the whatever be the ready inventory, day by day keep reducing. Newly launches almost zero. No developer willing to come out with the new launches. Cost of holding keep increasing. Like now you can't do any pre-launch, etc. You need to acquire the land, then you need to do all sanctions, then to go for RERA, then you go to the financial institution. I believe the small developer entirely out from the market. And the holding cost increased dramatically. And I'm sure the price at least 20-30% increase in next 12 to 15 months. And people feel, you know, the left out, we are not able to take a decision to buy. This is my personal thought. Related to the affordable housing, I think affordable housing is the wrong word, but all around people are talking around. The government focusing on EWS and LIG, not on affordable housing. Affordable housing, we people are talking like in Gurgaon, 50 lakhs rupees property is affordable. In Delhi, maybe crore rupees a property affordable. In Noida, Greater Noida, maybe 20 lakhs rupees. Or in New Mumbai or Mumbai, the same, you know, dynamic. EWS and LIG, I'm in a strong view, is not foray of the private developer. Very simple. A, the availability of the land, agriculture land, converting into the residential, then to get the approval, sanctions, cost of construction, and then to sale. And the margin is very thin. And to face all these kind of the issues, whatever be like RERA introduced, GST introduced, so many other compliances, day by day. I believe earlier, like we have a marketing department in the company, now we have the compliance department into the company. The compliancing cost much higher than the other cost within the company. So I think EWS and LIG, the foray of the government to deliver, affordable mid and luxury we need to deliver, and affordable, yes, the like property price below 50 lakhs, even saleable, but no one is focusing other than like the very, very few developer who is focusing to new launches, etc.
Rohtasji, two questions. What is the difference 2007 or 2017? Apne udhar bhi kaam kiya, and you raised a lot of capital, you did a lot of very good work, and you still continue to do very good work. Kya difference hai 2007 aur 2017 mein? One. And second is, affordable housing us time pe kyun nahi koi bolta tha? If it was that big a thing, and it was perennial demand, and itna sab kuch achha tha, aaj affordable housing buzzword hai, har aadmi bolta hai, main affordable housing hi karunga. To 2007 mein kyun nahi karte the?
सिंगल लाइन में मैं आंसर करूंगा इसका कि 2007 में अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग क्यों नहीं करते थे. एक्चुअली अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग के लिए जमीन जमीन की कीमत पे मिलनी चाहिए. 2007 में जमीन अफीम की कीमत पे मिल रही थी. जमीन की कीमत को अफीम की कीमत बना दी गई थी बाय क्रिएटिंग आर्टिफिशियल स्केर्सिटी ऑफ लैंड. मास्टर प्लान वाज सो स्मॉल एंड लेटर ऑन इट वाज इंक्रीज्ड. इफ यू हैव इंक्रीज्ड मास्टर प्लान लेटर ऑन, व्हाई द गवर्नमेंट एजेंसी इज नॉट इंक्रीज इन फर्स्ट गो? व्हाई आर्टिफिशियल स्केर्सिटी was created and made the jameen afim? So if the developers, everybody point out towards the developers. Developer is the just simple a vendor of government authority, nothing else, because he buy the land either from the authority or from the farmers and get approved again from the government authorities, make it FSI, then make it a house and then sell. So in this total process, his margin is 10 to 15% if low tide in this process, low tide is not there. Because in real estate, you know, after 3-4 years, there is a tide, low tide, high tide, low tide, high tide. It's very risky business. If there is no, you know, low tide, then he earn only 10 to 15%. But the government agencies make the land's cost as afim cost. How? The first reason is the master plan. Second reason is the cost. You know, in Haryana, city like Sonipat, city like Faridabad, city like Yamuna Nagar, city like Ambala, city like Bahadurgarh, how much is the cost? 8 crore rupees a acre in commercial. If you want to make some commercial, it's rather 10 crore rupees an acre, government fees, to make this, to convert this land into the FSI. And the basic land cost is 2 crore rupees, Pradeep, it is 2 crore rupees an acre. 10 crore rupees an acre is the government fees. So who's making this land costlier and who's making these affordable housing unaffordable? Are we responsible or the somebody else? Give it a thought. Why it is being unaffordable and the steps which are to be taken by the authorities or the government, the political will make everything happens. Now I feel there is a political will, there is a political will to make the houses affordable. Going forward, I feel, yes, in affordable housing, you know, as Prime Minister's vision by 2022, the housing for all, this under this policy, I feel, personally feel, there must be, they are or already some incentive, and further, because after giving so much of incentives, there is not big buzz today also in affordable housing. There is not big buzz, there is no, you know, big demand. You know, in Haryana, if you leave apart this Gurgaon, where is the demand of affordable housing? I don't feel in complete Haryana, in complete, you know, in under Haryana affordable housing policy, there is no demand and there is no viability also. If you leave Gurgaon, there is no viability also. So, as Pradeep Jain rightly said, affordable word is wrong word. Wrong word. If you really want to say affordable, then government will have to think a lot on it. Make the system very easy and smooth. You know, as Pradeep said, yes, you know, the other department, compliance department, is bigger than the marketing department today. I completely agree with Pradeep. So.
Thank you very much, Mr. Goel. I'm going to come to Anushri, you, but before that, Vineet, I just want to continue with what Mr. Rohtas Goel said. Is very interesting, two points that he mentioned. One is that where is the demand for affordable housing? And you're doing affordable housing all across India, including Gurgaon. So where is this demand coming in from? That's the first one. And the second is, I'll give you my mic, don't worry. The first is, you know, where is this demand coming in from? And second, what are the challenges that you are facing in delivering affordable housing?
Thanks, Anuj. So, you know, the way we look at affordable housing, I think affordable, like both the stalwarts mentioned, affordable is just a word which has been used to create a positive emotion in the country. I would actually give it three factors how it's being driven. You have a town and country planning which is trying to, you know, help certain people who are sitting with landlocked, which is bought expensively and doesn't have density or it has issues, it cannot be aggregated. So under the garb of affordable, you give them a certain license to monetize that land. You know, so the first driver for affordable is, TK, I have land there, I cannot do anything, let me do affordable housing there. So it's got nothing to do with providing homes to anybody, it has got to do with monetizing the land. Second issue why affordable people are trying to get in is because the markets are behaving in a way where the ticket prices have gone through the roof and you're not able to sell. So to maintain my cash flow, I do affordable housing, which I can actually reduce my price, but I can't do it, so I catch hold of somebody who has stuck up land, I will go out and reduce my price, try and do a Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, and by some hook or crook, give a discount indirectly. So affordable is covers my discount. Third, what I'm seeing is that there are some players who are coming into market whose objectives are again to probably create a revenue, create a big volume, create a IPO situation, create a balance sheet number. So they're just trying to jump into the fray. And there's nothing wrong about it. We did the same thing in 2007. Unfortunately, our experience is the business is a back-breaking business and it doesn't lead you anything 10 years down the line. You know, if you really frankly ask me, our objective of raising money globally was only middle income. We are a single product company, we do only middle income housing. Tickets other than Gurgaon, everywhere less than 50 lakhs, Gurgaon we can't do, so 1 crore is like minimum. But, you know, the point of the fact is it viable in that? I don't think it's viable. So as a policy, we had this big discussion because, you know, you have this lure of a lot of funds available for affordable housing. It's like the investment managers love the new flavor affordable housing, so everybody wants to jump there. But we took a conscious call that we're not getting into it because we've delivered enough scale. Our objectives are clearly to do only viable things, especially with the compliance and five-year DLPs coming into play.
And then, Vineet, you touched upon the point that there isn't enough
Demand. So I think your next question was demand. See, when you talk about demand, very correctly what was mentioned is that affordable, actually the country needs EWS. Let me give you a clear example. We have almost, if I'm not wrong, about 250 EWS in Gurgaon, right? The government told us clearly, till you don't get occupation certificate for this, we will not give you OC for the main housing, which we have sold. So we said, okay, no choice, we'll have to build it. After force from government, 5 years I'm trying to sell them 1.5 lakhs a piece, I've sold only 50. What Where is the saying? Customers?
EWS
is somebody has to understand this. Sitting in the central ministry, it is easy to do speeches. I don't have poor people to buy my homes. 1.5 lakh, EWS, 200 flats. Because why? You need a BPL card. Then you have a BPL card, you don't have poor people who have BPL cards here. You know, so where do I get those people who have a BPL card anyways? If somebody has who's living in Haryana, he's probably earning 7,000 bucks. Right? There's no way in the world he can afford even 1.5 lakh rupees. So there was another state, Ghaziabad. Now it's a political issue, Awas Yojana, whatever they call it. So the government has directed us, you give the homes free without taking money, you collect the money in 30 years. We have challenged it in court. Courts are not favorable to us. Finally, GDA has made some advance payment to us. We convinced them, Baba, you collect. We can't get into this rut of, you know, we're not a mortgage lender that I'm going to collect from those kind of people and it's a social cause. There's no way in the world I can collect. Now, lastly, you know, when you analyze why is the demand not there, for example, in our particular society, we tried then going out to some people, even our workers, drivers, convincing them, ki yaar, tum log hi le lo. There's pressure from government to sell. He said, sab nahi lena, itna dur hai, aane jaane mein meri jaan lag jayegi. Matlab, you know, it's like 2 hours from where my employment driver is. You know, so ultimately, if you look at the demand, there are two categories of demand. One is the educated suburban population, which all of us cater to. That population is looking at homes from 50 lakh to 1 crore, which is correctly pointed out. The other demand is EWS LIG, which is required closer to employment hubs. Because people need some commute mechanism. Surface transport is very weak in the country. So it's just not viable for them to live there.
Interesting. Yeah. Anushri, looking at you, I'm thinking is that, you know, maybe you should have been 10 years older. Because had you got your product 10 years ago, we may not have been in this situation. So Anushi's product is artificial intelligence. And if I correctly understand it, sort of right homes for the right people, assessing the demand and then thereby advising the developers what they should produce.
Yes, very correct.
Hello.
Yeah, so thanks Anuj for acknowledging me here and Realty Plus as well. A little bit about affordable housing, I'll really talk about our product as well. I somehow see affordable housing as a great opportunity for the country. I see as this as a cost optimization. If you talk of the builder fraternity, they are anyways constructing the inventories today. I feel if there are processes to monitor the construct today for the citizens, the question that my dear friends and realtors are debating today is that are we constructing the homes for the right audience, for the right intent of buying? If I set up satellite towns of affordable housing, will we have the right clientele or the right citizens, consumers to buy those homes? The answer is gray. People do not have the intelligence to understand whether I should construct in this city, this kind of area, and what kind of homes should I construct? Should I have homes which have the local vicinity of a metro station or an airport? That kind of intelligence I try to bring for the builders today through our engine, which is called Zivestimate. So it's like builders are empowered today to know that, look, my audience is here. This is what I should construct. I somehow feel that other stakeholders, let's say financial institutions, which are getting into sourcing the finance to the builders, they should have a process. The disbursement of the funds for these realtors should be through compliance. There is no process in the world which should not have any compliance. I tend to differ with good colleagues here that no process, let's say about construction and building, there's a method called CPM. So every construction which is going about in any site needs to have a metrics. How soon can you construct? When you talk about affordable housing, we need to construct fast, we need to sell fast, we need to deliver fast. That's what the basic aim of the government is here today. So I've been serving the government in the past years, and what I realize, a lot of PPP projects are running. A lot of guidelines are set by the government. But when it comes of terms of execution of those PPP projects, there is no compliance on the table. Ministries may pass on orders, but what about those compliance? Why are financial institutions giving huge amounts of money to those realtors who cannot execute the project, who falter at the deliveries, who do not cater to the intent of the buyer, of the consumer? That's the basic problem. But I somehow feel a little moved about this concept that why are builders not having this intelligence? Of course, with due respect to KPMG and other Knight Frank-like companies, I feel they should have their own the data. They should own the data through their own platform. They should know who their consumers are in the past trends, and they should also be able to predict the future trends of their own consumer. So in short, that's what Zivestimate, our artificial intelligence product, is all about. And I feel affordable housing is a good go-ahead for the country.
This thing, it's sometimes easy for us who are sitting outside to be able to look and say, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong. But you know, when you're inside the ring and you're playing that battle, this is like a forest. I don't know which animal is going to come from where and which is going to snap at you. You have no idea. No idea at all.
So you can read the consumer sentiments. The product can actually read. If the government says, I am passing this norm today, the product will read that. It will empower the builder to say, look, Pune is not a safe city to invest in as of now. Or maybe Hyderabad is the next IT city. I should invest into Hyderabad. Yeah. So reading the market sentiment is also a part of our product. We do that as well. So it will actually empower the builder. The builder will not say, I do not know where the demand is. He will actually see it in his dashboard.
No, that's very helpful. That is very helpful. These are two very key questions, and one to my thesis is only gone for a toss in this panel. Is that, where is this demand? I thought that demand was the only thing in affordable housing which was there. I mean, Rohtas says no, Vineet says no. I'm like, that was the only place where there was demand. There was no demand in premium. There's no demand in luxury. There is no demand that we're being able to find in the mid-level. And we thought that the demand was really on the affordable housing. And today on the panel, it appears that there is no demand in there as well. I don't know, kaha reh rahe hain log sare? One. Second is how do you produce margins on affordable housing? I mean, is there a game? Is this only cash flow, like Vineet said, is that it's a cash flow? Is there really profitable business that you can deliver?
Yes. Affordable housing, naturally, the game changer. Anushri rightly said, abhi hum traditional mindset se chal rahe hain, jo humne peeche kiya hai. Hum usse change nahi karna chahte, because aisa hi dekha hai, aisa hi hota hai. Out of the box jaake koi thinking nahi. Ab dekhe ki hum logon ka experience nahi hai real estate ka. Financial market se belong karte hain. 1995 से फाइनेंशियल मार्केट में हैं. 2013 में जब अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग पॉलिसी डिज़ाइन की हरियाणा गवर्नमेंट ने, हम लोगों ने एक सर्वे रिसर्च कराया जिसमें बड़ा ड्रामेटिक रिजल्ट था कि कोई भी बिल्डर जो है वो पूरी के पूरी हरियाणा के अंदर ना ही ज़्यादा इंटरेस्टेड है करने में और ना ही कर रहा है. इवन डिमांड इतनी ज़्यादा है कि अगर आप 1000 फ्लैट लॉन्च कर रहे हैं तो विद इन 15 डेज आप 5000 लोगों को अपने ऑफिस में एक राशन की दुकान की तरह भीड़ लगाए हुए देख रहे हैं. रोहतास जी, प्रदीप जी ने जैसे कहा कि कैसे डिमांड कैसे बनी, यानी क्या डिमांड बनी, मेरा कंसर्न है कि नहीं, शायद जो एक माइंडसेट हमारा रहा है उससे बाहर निकलिए. बिजनेस चेंज हो चुका है. अगर हमने अपने आप को चेंज नहीं किया तो रियल में आने वाला जो टाइम है वो सारा का सारा जो कॉरपोरेट लोग हैं बड़े या इंस्टीट्यूशंस हैं वो अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग में आएंगे और आपका जो डिकेट्स का एक्सपीरियंस है वो विदाउट एनी कॉस्ट लेके जाने वाले हैं. क्योंकि आने वाला टाइम अगले 10 साल सिर्फ अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग का है. आज शायद अंडरस्टैंड भी नहीं कर पा रहे हैं इन कंपनीज की वैल्यूएशंस को. मैं मान के चल रहा हूँ 2013 का अगर मैं नंबर मान के चलूँ तो इन लैक्स, इन बिलियंस ऑफ द बिलियंस इन अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग कंपनीज की वैल्यूएशन मिलेगी. लेकिन जो प्लेयर्स होंगे वो बिल्कुल डिफरेंट होंगे. फाइनेंशियल मार्केट का एक एक्सपीरियंस शेयर कर रहा हूँ आपके साथ. 1995 में जो शेयर ब्रोकर होते थे वो लगभग 2000 के नियर अबाउट होते थे. और शेयर ब्रोकर की एक इमेज होती है कि
बड़ी
शेयर ब्रोकर,
टिकट लेनी बड़ी बात होती
है, बड़ी बात होती. लेकिन आप 2017 में बात करें, जितने बिग ब्रोकर हैं 90% जो मार्केट है वो लगभग 20 लोगों के पास सेंट्रलाइज हो चुका है. और उनकी वैल्यूएशंस कितनी हाई हैं, किसी की 20,000 करोड़, किसी की 15,000 करोड़ और किसी की 25,000 करोड़. उन लोगों ने कंप्लायंट काम किया है. कंप्लायंसेस, कंप्लायंट क्यों ना करें, आप बताएं ना रीजन क्यों ना हो. पहले दिन जिस दिन लाइसेंस आपको मिलता है सारी चीजें उस पर मेंशन है कि आपको ऐसे 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 करना है. तो कंप्लायंस हमारे लिए पार्ट कैसे हो सकता है, वो हमें पहले दिन करना है. अभी तक हम शायद नहीं कर रहे थे तो हमें लग रहा है कि रेरा आने से दिक्कत है. इवन आप देखिए सेबी जो इतना स्ट्रिक्ट नॉर्म जिसके रहते हैं, अगर मुझे लगता है सेबी को किसी ने बियर कर लिया तो रेरा इज नथिंग. मुझे लगता है वहां तो ये सिचुएशन है कि मार्जिन, अगर फॉर एग्जांपल मेरे पास क्लाइंट 1 लाख क्लाइंट हैं, शाम को मुझे मार्जिन डालना है तो किसी का 1 रुपीज भी अगर मार्जिन शॉर्ट है तो एक नोटिस आएगा कि इसका मार्जिन आपने शॉर्ट अपडेट कर दिया. यहां पे हमें रेरा में तो ऐसी बहुत सारी चीजें हैं जो बहुत रिलैक्स लग रही हैं. आने वाले टाइम में और ज्यादा कंप्लायंस बढ़ेंगे यहां पे. लेकिन इन नटशेल अगर आप डिमांड की बात करें तो मैं केवल इतना कह सकता हूं कि लास्ट 2 साल में हमने 10,000 यूनिट गुड़गांव में, मेन गुड़गांव में, जैसे प्रदीप जी ने कहा गुड़गांव में कैसे पॉसिबल है, मैंने मेन गुड़गांव में 2 BHK फ्लैट 22 लाख रुपए में लोगों को प्रोवाइड कराए हैं. इट्स नॉट ए अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग, इट्स ए वैल्यू बेस्ड हाउसिंग जो लोगों की सोच से बाहर है. मुझे लगता है कि इस पॉलिसी के अंदर जाके उसको आराम से देखें, समझें कि किन लोगों के लिए राइट प्रोडक्ट क्या है. बॉटम द पिरामिड पे इतनी ज्यादा डिमांड है कि अभी मैंने लास्ट एक प्रोजेक्ट लॉन्च किया था उसमें 2000 यूनिट थे, 45 डेज में 8000 से ज्यादा लोगों ने मेरे पास उसमें एप्लीकेंट.
माय गॉड,
लोग कहते हैं डिमांड नहीं है. मैं कहता हूं अगले 2022 तक 1 लाख से ज्यादा घर हम लोगों को बुक कर चुके होंगे या उनमें से कुछ नंबर्स डिलीवर भी कर चुके होंगे ऑल ओवर इंडिया. वी आर प्लानिंग दैट. और ये बात जितने डेवलपर भाई हैं जितनी जल्दी समझेंगे उतनी जल्दी इस बिजनेस में आ जाएंगे. अदरवाइज जैसे मैंने आपको बताया 1995 में जो ब्रोकरेज होती थी वो 4% 3% ऐसे कुछ टर्म्स में होती थी. आज अगर बात करें ब्रोकरेज की तो वो 1 करोड़ पे 1,000 रुपए, ओनली 1,000 रुपीज. लेकिन इस टाइम पे जो वॉल्यूम है मार्केट का वो 10 लाख करोड़ रुपए पर डे है और उस टाइम पे कुछ करोड़ रुपीज होता था. तो आप कंपैरिजन कर लीजिए कि ये वॉल्यूम बेस्ड बिजनेस है. वॉल्यूम बेस्ड बिजनेस करने में आपको फायदा क्या होने वाला है, जो आपका क्वांटम है, एक तो आपका प्राइस कम लैंड करेगा, आप अपने वेंडर से जो सप्लाई लेंगे वो आपको ज्यादा बेहतर रेट पे आएगी और आपका जो ये कस्टमर है, बिल्कुल आप ध्यान से सुनेगा इस चीज को, ये जो कस्टमर है इससे ज्यादा रिच कोई कस्टमर नहीं है. 1 करोड़ रुपए वाले की इन्वेस्टमेंट हो सकती है, इसका वो रियल घर है, इसका वही ताजमहल है. वो पहले 3 महीने पहले उस EMI जो भी किस्त है उसकी वो पहले से घर में रखता है कि मेरे ऊपर ब्याज ना लग जाए, मैं जाके डेवलपर को दे. तो आई थिंक माइंडसेट चेंज करना पड़ेगा, बिल्कुल एंटायर सीन चेंज हो चुका है। अगर हम एक ट्रेडिशनल माइंडसेट से चलेंगे कि प्रॉफिट मार्जिन कहाँ है, नो डाउट प्रॉफिट मार्जिन बहुत थिन है, लेकिन वॉल्यूम इतना ज्यादा है और लिक्विडिटी इतनी ज्यादा है, आज सबसे ज्यादा लिक्विड इशू है, इसमें लिक्विडिटी इतनी ज्यादा है कि आप काम करते हैं अगेन एंड अगेन, आपका कस्टमर आपको पैसे दे रहा है, आपका माल रुक नहीं रहा, सबसे ज्यादा जीते जब आपका पूरा का पूरा स्टॉक आप जीरो रेट जीरो डेट पे जीरो इन्वेंट्री के साथ खड़े हों, तो फिर आपको बनाने में मुझे लगता है आपको और ज्यादा इनोवेटिव आइडियाज लाने पड़ेंगे, लाइक चाइना से या और ऐसी चीजें लानी पड़ेंगी जिससे हम इनको दो साल में ढाई साल में इन घर को डिलीवर कर पाएं, ना कि ये पांच साल सात साल का जो पैटर्न चला है इसको खत्म करके दो से ढाई साल में लोगों को डिलीवरी दें और उन लोगों को उनका घर दें जो लोग हमारी तरफ बहुत उम्मीद से देख रहे हैं। आज बहुत गाढ़े में खून पसीनी की कमाई उन्होंने 20 लाख रुपए हमें दी है और अगर हम उनके घर नहीं देते हैं तो बड़ा मुश्किल है डिलीवर। थैंक यू,
वेरी नाइस।
जस्ट वन क्विक आई थिंक सबको बताने के लिए कि अभी तक कितना डिलीवर हो गया, आपने कितना डिलीवर किया है?
देखिए 2013 की पॉलिसी है ये।
हाँ जी,
जो पहले लाइसेंसेज इशू हुए हैं वो 2014 में इशू हुए हैं, 15 मार्च से कंस्ट्रक्शन स्टार्ट हुई है।
आपने शुरू करी है?
हाँ, यानी जो फर्स्ट प्रोजेक्ट मेरा ही स्टार्ट हुआ है, जो गवर्नमेंट की तरफ से टाइम है वो 4 साल का है, लेकिन हम लोगों ने जो टाइम की अपनी तरफ से डिलीवरी का टाइम रखा है 3 साल रखा है। 2018 मार्च में हम पहली डिलीवरी कर रहे हैं अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग की, 2018 जून में दूसरी कर रहे हैं और 18 दिसंबर में तीसरी कर रहे हैं, बिल्कुल एंटायर, बल्कि ये जो पीरियड हमारा 3 साल का रहा है, नेक्स्ट टाइम जितने भी प्रोजेक्ट आ रहे हैं हम 2.5 साल में ट्राई कर रहे हैं कि उसे 2.5 साल में डिलीवरी का।
वेरी नाइस Pradeep ji, 2 questions to you. You are smiling. You've heard everybody speak. Rohtas, I'll come to you as well because this may be a little bit divergent view. जो आपके views हैं और जो जो इनके views हैं, कुछ मिलते हैं, कुछ थोड़े से divergent हैं। इसलिए भी divergent है क्योंकि Pradeep ji, you and Rohtas have been in business for much longer. In there, as you have experienced a lot of it.
I agree with you. I completely agree with, yes, affordable housing is viable in Gurgaon. But where is the city? Which is the city in Haryana, under Haryana affordable housing scheme, which is affordable? And in Gurgaon also, you are talking about 2015, where the sale prices in normal houses was 10,000 to 12,000 rupees a square feet. Today, that price already down to 7,000 to 8,000 in affordable housing. Rate fixed rate, this is the government fixed rate is 4,000 rupees on carpet area. So on super area basis, it should not be more than 3,000 rupees square feet. So today 3,000 is a challenge here. You try to understand, you are selling at that point of time where the normal houses were sold at 10,000 rupees and you are selling at 3,000 rupees. Today normal houses are coming down to 7,000 to 8,000. So today, I'm sorry to say this, it's not viable today. Also, the FSI cost has gone up, construction cost has gone up, and your price is the constant. But the customer will not accept your that price which was 5 years ago. He will also ask some discount today. So my question is this. And you leave Gurgaon. So which is the city where this is affordable? No, have you touched any other city other than Gurgaon?
Actually, this is not the story actually. ऐसा नहीं है सिर्फ गुड़गांव में ही डिमांड है, इवन राजनगर, वन ऑफ द नियरस्ट प्लेस इन यूपी, अभी हमने 25 लाख स्क्वायर फीट का प्रोजेक्ट हम नेक्स्ट क्वार्टर में लॉन्च कर रहे हैं। आप ये मान के चलिए कि वहाँ पे और भी प्रोजेक्ट लॉन्च हो चुके, सेम समाजवादी आवास योजना में लॉन्च थे, इन सेम
आपको बोलने की जरूरत इसलिए नहीं पड़ेगी क्योंकि राजनगर एक्सटेंशन की आप बात जो कर रहे हैं, राजनगर एक्सटेंशन में जो गुड़गांव अफोर्डेबल पॉलिसी के बेनिफिट हैं, क्या वो मिलते हैं आपको? मिलते हैं
एक्चुअली सॉरी जैसे हरियाणा में अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग पॉलिसी है, ऐसे समाजवादी आवास योजना के नाम से लास्ट गवर्नमेंट ने इस पॉलिसी को नोटिफाई किया था, अभी इस पॉलिसी का नाम मुख्यमंत्री आवास योजना उन्होंने चेंज करके किया है, सेम पॉलिसी, वहां भी वो 3000 रुपीज सुपर बिल्टअप के ऊपर उन्होंने रेट को ब्लॉक किया हुआ है। इवन सेम वे हरियाणा में ही जो अदर देन सिटी आप कह रहे हैं उसमें एक स्कीम और भी गवर्नमेंट ने लॉन्च की थी दीनदयाल आवास योजना के नाम से, जिसमें इन्होंने 100 गज के प्लॉट, 100-125 गज के प्लॉट, तो आप ही मान के चलिए उसमें भी जो टिकट साइज है वो 20-22 लाख रुपए का है। और आप ये देखिए कि उसमें भी डिमांड का जो वे है बिल्कुल डिट्टो सेम वे है, फर्क केवल इतना है टिकट साइज, हम क्या बना रहे हैं और लोग क्या चाहते हैं। हम घर 1 करोड़ रुपए वाले बना रहे हैं, लोगों की डिमांड 20 लाख रुपए वाले की है। 20 लाख रुपए हमारा फोटे नहीं है बनाने का, क्योंकि हमने कभी सोचा भी नहीं, उतना तो हम एसेसरी के ऊपर खर्च देते हैं उन यूनिट्स में 2 करोड़ या 4 करोड़ वाली में। दैट इज द प्रॉब्लम कि माइंडसेट हमारा 20 लाख रुपए की यूनिट में बन ही नहीं सकता। हमारे लिए थोड़ा सा बेनिफिट ये रहा कि हम क्लीन थे पीछे से, हमने माइंडसेट हमारा कैरी नहीं हुआ। अदरवाइज आज जो दूसरे डेवलपर हैं उनका ये कह रहा था कि इतने कम रेट के ऊपर कंस्ट्रक्शन कैसे पॉसिबल है। मैं कह रहा हूँ पॉसिबल, अगर पॉसिबल नहीं तो मेरे लिए बिजनेस ही नहीं है, व्हाई आई एम सिटिंग हियर, कोई मीनिंग ही नहीं बनेगा मेरे लिए। बिजनेस है, फर्क क्या है कि आप कितने क्वांटम पे कितनी स्पीड पे आप अपनी डिलीवरी को डिलीवर कर रहे हैं और कितना आप जो अपने अपने वेंडर से जो माल सप्लाई ले रहे हैं वो किस वे में ले रहे हैं। अगर आपका पेमेंट प्लान उसका 3 महीने 6 महीने का पेमेंट देने का, तो उसके जो प्राइस है वो 10% 20% ऊपर मिलेंगे आपको। आप उसे कैश आउट करिए ना, कि आप उसे कहिए कि मैं आपको एक दिन में पेमेंट देता हूं, आप बताइए क्या रेट पे करेंगे। नेचुरली बात है आपके प्राइस जो है वो नीचे आ जाएंगे सप्लाई।
Pradeep ji, your views, and then I'm going to go to Anushri and Vineet.
See, meri samajh mein baat jo Aggarwal sahab ne kahi baat kisi had tak theek hai, lekin abhi din nikla hai, shaam honi baki hai. Jab 2015 mein Aggarwal sahab ne, I know personally very well, jab 2015 mein Aggarwal sahab ne affordable housing Gurgaon mein bechni shuru ki, us time pe 1500 rupaye cash lete the सारे डेवलपर, जितने भी अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग के डेवलपर गुड़गांव में काम कर रहे थे। उस टाइम पे हम लोग लग्जरी जो है 12,000-15,000-16,000 रुपए फुट में बेचते थे। मार्केट इट वॉज डिफरेंट, नाउ द मार्केट इज डिफरेंट एंड गुड़गांव इज यूनिक। मैं उसको अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग नहीं बोलता, मैं एज आई सेड अर्लियर EWS एंड LIG इज ए एंटायरली डिफरेंट कैटेगरी। 20 लाख का यूनिट गुड़गांव में, जहां पर आज 1 करोड़ रुपए से कम का यूनिट सोना रोड NH8 एंड आपकी एक्सटेंशन, इसके बीच में कहीं 1 करोड़ रुपए में प्रॉपर्टी नहीं मिलती है। या NH8 के अंदर में जब आप 20 लाख रुपए का कोई यूनिट बनाकर उसको दे रहे हो तो उसको सूट करता है, बट जब हम दूसरी सिटीज में हरियाणा में चले जाते हैं, आई बिलीव आई हैव ए प्रेजेंस ऑलमोस्ट इन एवरी सिटी ऑफ हरियाणा एज वेल एज इन UP, ओके, एंड आई डू अंडरस्टैंड कि कोई किस एरिया में किस प्राइस पे क्या चीज बिकेगी। आज जो आपने प्लान किया कि हम 3 साल में प्रॉपर्टी डिलीवर कर देंगे, अगर वो 3 साल में डिलीवरी हो जाती है तो परफेक्ट है, आपको 7% का मार्जिन मिलेगा, 7 से 8 नहीं मिलता, 7 ही मिलेगा। लेकिन अगर वो 36 महीने से 48 हो गया तो जेब से पैसे देने पड़ेंगे और फिर वो शाम होनी भी बाकी है, वही वाली बात आके खड़ी हो जाएगी। तो मास्क में तो आप कोई भी काम करो तो सूट करता है। 2007 में आज अग्रवाल साहब जो बात बता रहे, 2006-2007 में हमने पूरे वर्ल्ड को बताया कि रियल एस्टेट हिंदुस्तान में क्या होता है। यू नो आई गिव यू, आई एम गोइंग कंप्लीटली ऑफ ट्रैक, व्हेन आई गो आउटसाइड द कंट्री टू एड्रेस द ग्लोबल इन्वेस्टर फॉर IPO, आई वॉज द फर्स्ट कंपनी टू कम आउट विद द IPO।
यू वर बिफोर रोहतास?
Rohtas follow me.
And you followed
yeah,
him.
He followed
okay.
me.
Okay.
Us time pe Anuj, you must know the entire investment, global investment in this country, I'm talking, $2.2 billion.
That's it?
In real estate sector as a whole. The day I file a DRHP in SEBI, the entire market cap of all real estate company in India, not more than 500 crore. And I have filed the DRHP to raise 1100 crore rupees. Just you think. And when we made to the people outside the country, eye opener, I make the government to understand to allow IPO to real estate company, because they say, no, FDI, only to the FDI, this is a foreign investment. I was the first company to whom they allow the foreign investment to participate, foreign FIIs to participate into the IPO. So, and the time is different.
Yeah.
Again, after 2 years or after 3 years, when the market stabilizes, some of the people, they feel the RERA is a threat, I feel advantage. You know, everything you need to look at as an advantage, but time takes, okay? From last 25 years, last 20 years, we have done a lot. We already delivered 30,000 units. Every day we are delivering. From last couple of years, we are not launching. Why should we launch new project under RERA, under GST? If you have a capability, better to sell the ready-to-build house.
Completed answer.
In time to come, in NCR today, what I understand, there is a 10,000 developer. Maybe 10,000 developer converted into 200 developer in next 2 years' time. And then you can see the people offer only the ready to move in. The compliance is not a threat, but business you need to be settled. How you want to do the business, basic thing is that.
I'm going to wind this up. Vineet, you know, you wanted to add, and I just one more thing if you can add is, Vineet, you know, we discussed about corporate governance, and I think that is what the discussion has been largely on this side. You know, you're amongst the most corporate governance high, foreign money, very, very corporate. Tell us, what are the challenges that you face in an environment like this to be able to adhere to the highest standards of corporate governance? And then you wanted to add something on the previous topic as well.
So in terms of corporate governance, yes, you know, we've faced a lot of issues, and you know, to frankly tell you, sometimes you felt that your hands and legs are tied and you're put in a boxing match, you know, so you just kind of get hit from every side because you got to comply with everything, but you got to follow all the business practices of the land. You can't survive without that. Having said that, so corporate governance, yes, we've kind of worked out processes where we have managed to, you know, escape through the entire thing for 10 years without any kind of dot on our balance sheets or anywhere. The other issue was also that we invested heavily in terms of, you know, like CPM and a whole lot of quality initiative involving a lot of global practices which we brought in here. But, you know, gradually with time, the budgets and the pricings have shrunk so much that we've got into handling the customer activism more. So from a compliance, you also have a, you have a police department, you have an IT department which handles tax, you know, so there's so many of these new things which were really not planned that one day we'll have to get into all that, but you can't survive without them. You know, if you want to survive and deliver, you got to really have those things in place. And finally, because you're, you know, the pie size is very limited and it's shrinking, you got to decide your priorities end of the day. So it, the quality and the governance takes a hit somewhere. You know, you end up changing auditors because you realize, boss, ye chalega nahi auditor, he's going to put you into a lot of trouble, you know. So there is definitely, you know, the margins getting squeezed puts a pressure on cost, which definitely takes a toll on governance. Now, what I was going to say was, I have not met Mr. Aggarwal earlier, but we have a common investor, you know, so we've had this discussion without him in our office many times. So our storyline was exactly what he said in 2007. We exactly said this. Only 20 lakh ka ghar, you announce and by evening it is sold out. There was no different, we said very limited margin, construction efficiencies, foreign money, only valuation was the only objective. Sir, the only problem which happened over 10 years or whatever experience, very limited experience I have, is that two things really hit us badly, that with time, once, you know, because the business has a lot of moving parts, there are these so many uncertainties which just hit you at any stage of the project. You know, suddenly one joker in the government gets up and decides a new policy and you're hit. And you've not accounted that because your margins were really thin. So gradually we noticed that the margins started shrinking and probably in some phases we became negative at some point in time. But because the commitment was there because of corporate governance, we had to deliver. So we had to take a, you know, cost burn. And the other big thing which, you know, and again the reason was same because all our guys were from the finance industry. We are nobody from real estate, you know. So
that's right.
The logic reasoning was exactly what you mentioned. And you know, what we realized when we came to the time of valuations and trying to, you know, encash all the good work we had done, that very few people bought into the EBITDA story in real estate. You know, most of the IPC especially and most of the guys who are opinion makers, all they would say ki kitni land hai, iski valuation nikalo, isko divide karke itna kar do. We were trying to harp, boss, EBITDA hai, 200 crore EBITDA hai, dekho itne kam pe. nobody really bought the EBITDA story, and still I've seen and I interact very closely with the large fund managers who specifically look at real estate. I don't think the EBITDA story is still selling. You know, it sells in Mexico, it sells in the US where you're homemakers with 40,000 consistency. And one of the key issues I think what people have is that to maintain a consistent supply of raw material of land is always a challenge. You have market uncertainty, so EBITDA really does not, really work there. So if without EBITDA working, valuation is always going to be a challenge. So hence the decision that we do slightly upper 7,000 product, not a 3,000 product anymore.
Great, thank you, Vineet. I know we've run out of time, but Anushri, I want you to close this. We are at the dawn of the new era, what do you believe that you can contribute with the fantastic product that you have bought in to the Indian real estate industry?
I feel the major stakeholder, which is the builder or the developer today, has the maximum skin in the game. They put all the financial risk. They put their brand name into building up inventories and homes for the citizens and consumers. But again, getting to the topic of affordable housing is a community mission. How many of us are actually thinking of those slums which are in around the city? Bombay is one big major city which has a lot of slums. How many of us think that those people also need homes today? Is it just a commercial motive to build affordable housing? When you talk of compliance, when we talk of processes, I have run the government in railways. It has to be there. It has to be there in real estate as well, be it a construction, be it selling of the inventories. Real estate is entire cycle. It's not just selling of inventories. It is about servicing those consumers, servicing those inventories as well. So if the major stakeholders, government A, B, the real estate stakeholder, and the financial institution, which when I talked about the PPP model, certain builders are here to stay for long if they will serve the masses. How many of us know that 67% of the Indian population still stay on rent today and they can afford homes, but they're not getting the right homes which they actually need? If I'm staying in Noida, I would not want to go and stay in a Gurgaon affordable housing, right? So I would need affordable housing in Noida. But where is that data source which will empower me, be it a financial institution, be it a capital market investor, be it a developer, that I need to construct homes in only Noida? And this would be my target audience, this would be my selling bracket, this would be the future, right? I feel the government, other than just coming up with policies, they need to have an intermediary body which will enable the builders or the developers and even the financial institution to give them the intelligence to know where and what and how to sell all these inventories. Because real estate is the backbone of the country, and the GDP is certainly going to go threefold if affordable housing is given the right support. Because the demand is always there. As I said, 67% population need homes today. And coming back to my product, as I said, I'm more into technology innovation. I built SaaS model for Indian Railways, meaning whatever functions Indian Railways had, we source it to every travel portal and online platform. The same kind of platform I want to build for real estate. If you are owning your inventory, you should have your own data. You should know what has been had 10 years ago and what should be 10 years ahead. Because you are the one who is constructing the homes, right? So that kind of a product I'm trying to build for the country, and I hope everybody is enrolled in that solution.
Thank you very much. So just to sum this up very quickly, it seems like demand is very much there, Mr. Aggarwal. That is that seems to be the verdict. I think, Rohtas, your point is on the land, and it's not the land cost, but it's the government premiums. That is making land unaffordable, and then how do you construct affordable on unaffordable land prices? I think Pradeep ji, your consolidation, absolutely, 10,000 developers today, perhaps in Gurgaon, 200 developers in 3 years' times, 4 years' times, consolidation. Perhaps the market will move to ready to move in inventory with RERA coming in. That is where it does appear. Compliance, I think all of us agree on this panel, has to be met. I mean, it is, Mr. Aggarwal, the point that you say is there's no way about it. It's that what was done in the past is not going to take us to the next level. It has to be a different genre of compliance that we'll have to do. Is, I think, Anushree, from your point, intelligence, data, and have a predictive analysis rather than have a gut feel before you go and do that. And Vineet, two interesting points that you say is, one, is, you know, compliance is easy to say but difficult to deliver and afford, and hence the compromises come in. And second is, I can conclude by saying is that the verdict is still not out on whether the developer is going to make money on this or not. As he said, is in his own words, is what do you say? That subah ho gayi, abhi sham baki hai. So I think is that verdict is still yet to be seen. So thank you very much. With this, I'll close the panel.
Thank you so much. I request you to stay back, please, because I request all the panelists to kindly remain seated. We're going to take some questions. I think that was an interesting panel discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, could we have a huge round of applause? And we'll now keep the floor open for questions, because I think let's extend the debate even further. And let's take your questions. No, we are good. We are absolutely good at the time. Sure, please.
Yeah, I'm Ravinder Aggarwal from ACRI, Association of Certified Realtors of India. I respect Vineet ji very much, and you know, he said he's got a units for 1.5 lakhs and he can't sell it. I don't know where they are. So can you please let us know where?
Sir, aap har conference mein aate ho, main har conference mein yahi bolta hu. EWS housing Gurgaon mein agar aapko khareedni hai, as a developer it is compulsory for me to build it and get a occupation certificate before my normal housing gets a OC. If you want to buy, you have to get a BPL card, below the poverty line card, in your name. Apply to the government and we will allot the unit to you. It's in sector 92 Gurgaon, but you'll have similar inventories even closer to the city. So the issue is that they were, in the earlier days, people used to just sell it to the government officers without taking BPL cards. But like friend said, compliance is important, so that we don't sell it without compliance.
Please. So, yeah, KJ, Colonel KJ Singh again from ACRI. You see, you started off very well, and I'm very happy that on this panel we had panelists with divergent views. I tend to go by seasoned realtors who are there, you know, Mr. Pradeep Jain and Mr. Rohtas, Goel and Vineet, Relia. You see, we are mixing up somewhere. And my apologies, ma'am, your data also, we are mixing up somewhere in your data also. You know, whatever you're trying to find out.
She's just preparing that data. She hasn't yet delivered it.
You know, what Vineet has said is absolutely right. EWS, who are the buyers in the EWS? Most of the EWS, if they were very well located, are today sold on the power of attorney to somebody else. Okay, and they have been bought by somebody who could manage the BPL card, irrespective of whatever his income was. Okay, so those 1.5 lakhs houses. And of course, it is very difficult for anybody who's developing on Dwarka Expressway or anywhere else to sell those 1.5 lakhs. So that's difficult. So Signature Global has done very well in the affordable housing segment. But affordable housing segment, like Mr. Jain said, it was the time when other things were available at 12,000 rupees a square foot. So a small investor, you know, who thought that he has 20 lakhs real estate mein invest karna hai, logon ne paisa banaya, main kya karun? Okay, main affordable mein dal deta hun. Please, if you can analyze your data and see how many are end users in that and how many are investors. Jab sham hogi na, in his words, you'll realize that you know, the structures will be standing. There will be no takers, there will be no exit. So when you say whether it's a dream or reality, it is a reality for the landowner. It may be reality for a builder who's been able to sell it well, but it remains a dream for the end user, the customer who has bought the affordable housing as an investment. It is going to be a dream which is not turned true. I mean, this is the verdict that we had also talked about this earlier sometime. What we need is rental housing, ma'am. We are mixing up the people who are living in the
Jhugi Jhopri. We'll have to have others as
Jhugi
well.
Jhugi Jhopri. Yeah. You know, you need rental housing first.
No, we understand it.
Push that's for right. That rental housing.
I think it was an observation. There was no question in there. Please.
Hi, good evening, panel. My name is Chirag and I'm a real estate consultant. So my question is to Anuj, sir. So, like, we have seen both sides, like, debating about why affordable is good and why affordable is not good. And talking about Mr. Vineet, that we have seen 2007, like we have sold properties like Vatika and Sare Homes coming up with properties starting from 20, 22 lakhs. And then they have appreciated like anything. They sold like crazy. Now, if we talk about Signature Global as a group, yes, affordable housing has been sold in Gurgaon. But as ma'am said, that we are catering to the class that is middle income and lower income currently to pull that crowd over here and buy homes which cannot afford a crore rupee house. So, and considering that, what is your take? Like, will this, like, and that is the reason I'm thinking all the big brands like Adani's or ATS or for that matter Raheja's are coming into affordable housing segment. Is this whether to boost the other sales as well or to continue with this pattern that yeah, the flow is going towards affordable and we should go towards affordable only to make money or to get like people in our boat and so that we can survive or move ahead? So what is your take, sir?
And so very quickly, I know that we're going to run out of time and it's not really, I am as a panelist, I'm a moderator, so I should not be taking questions. But very quickly, two things. It cannot be because they want to sell premium that they're getting into affordable housing. It's a completely different segment.
Yes.
You know, that guy is not going to be an affordable housing guy, one. Second is, you know, I tend to agree with Mr. Aggarwal that, you know, we've been in this industry for much longer and hence we become skeptics. I value his knowledge. I value what he brings onto the table. I think we should give chance to people like Mr. Aggarwal because otherwise, you know, the gentleman there, what he said is our views are very much his views. But I think we will have to restrict and we will have to look at Mr. Aggarwal and say, how can he become a success? Because he's saying is that at 7, 10, 11, 12% margin, as a freestanding unit, I'm going to make this profitable. I'm not doing this because I have an ambition to get into premium or luxury. I'm making this as a business. And that is what I want to see. And I do feel is that there will be people like him who are going to be successful because that is where the demand is.
Absolutely. So just to add, like there are developers who have already like reduced their prices. I'll just take 1 minute more. So developers who have reduced their prices, particularly talking about Gurgaon market. So they have like a builder like Raheja, he has come up with a property which is almost equivalent to a affordable housing price. So, and if we calculate the carpet area for affordable starts from like 400, 500 square feet. So the thing is, why are the, like there is already a gap in terms of the percentage of reduced prices. So why is that? So why are the developers coming down with the prices of 4,000, 4,500, 4,800 rupees per square feet in Gurgaon market and they're again selling? So why is that gap? Like, can't we maintain that price of 6,000, 7,000? Yes, we are in a sluggish market, but still, like, isn't it degrading our standards, like the big developers' standards?
Degrading your standard. Sir, ek cheez hoti hai, word hota hai liquidity. Uski value hoti hai. That is what it is. Wo liquidity aap de do, wo nahi bechenge. Bechna padta hai.
डिग्रेड क्वालिटी डिग्रेड करने से होती है उसका स्टैंडर्ड किसी डेवलपर प्राइस अगर वो कम करता तो उसकी क्या वैल्यू डिग्रेड होगी
नो सर
अदर वैल्यू अपग्रेड होगी रादर उसकी
आई वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट द क्वालिटी ओनली बिकॉज़ लाइक द प्राइसेस फॉर द प्रोडक्ट्स आर हायर एंड द मार्जिन्स आर लेस एज वी वर टॉकिंग अबाउट दैट इज व्हाट आई मेंशनड
I think the developers are disagreeing. They're saying that the quality hasn't gone down. The price may have gone down, but
so subjective. I have a question about the quality. My name is Sanjay Vadwa. I'm an architect from SWPI Architects. Affordable housing, we talked about, Mr. Aggarwal. My question is very simple. Somebody said the houses are going to stay. Somebody said, you know, so at whatever price you are mentioning, it's fantastic. And how achievable, what is the quality of construct? What is the life? Typically, when we construct buildings, civil buildings, we talk about 40, 50 years of life. So, you know, land is scarce. And somebody talked about slums. I'm sure you talked about slums. My question is that are we, and I'm just don't get me wrong here, I'm totally talking from a design perspective, ki hum slums ko convert karke, koi pakke slums to nahi bana rahe jo 10 saal mein leak hone shuru ho jayenge ya 5 saal mein. You know, waterproofing is never our greatest. So can any of you tell us what is the way forward there? Is it really viable? Is it really worth it? Should we pursue that line at all or not?
Actually, bilkul bhi aisa nahi hai. Maine kaha na out of the box jaake thinking kari thoda sa.
हमें ना पॉलिसी को अंडरस्टैंड करना पड़ेगा, जिसे भी उन्होंने कहा कि कम रेट पे भी लॉन्च होने के बाद माल क्यों नहीं बिक पा रहा है या क्यों रेट पे काम कर रहे हैं। इस पे टिकट साइज बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज है, या क्वालिटी कोई कॉम्प्रोमाइज हो ही नहीं सकता। क्वालिटी के अंदर आप देखिए वन ऑफ द बेस्ट क्वालिटी, इवन आप देखिए लोग नॉर्मली जो एलएनटी शार्प ओलंजी जो माइवन जो एल्युमिनियम शटरिंग यूज करते हैं, हम सारे के सारे प्रोजेक्ट्स में एल्युमिनियम शटरिंग यूज कर रहे हैं। इवन हफीज कॉन्ट्रैक्टर जो है वो सारी की सारी सोसाइटीज डिजाइन कर रहे हैं। आप समझिए कि कैसे पॉसिबल है कि आप किसी भी क्वालिटी के अंदर कॉम्प्रोमाइज कर पाए।
ओके, या ग्रेट ग्रेट आंसर सर, थैंक यू।
Thank you very much. With this, I'm just going to hand it back to the young lady here.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I would also request Mr. Sameer Dande from Formica Laminates India Private Limited to come forward to present mementos to our panelists. I request our panelists to kindly stay back, please. Mr. Sameer Dande, request you to come forward to present the mementos. Could we have a huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen? Not just for our panelists, but for all of you. Those are some interesting questions also that came up. I'm sure you would want to connect with our panelists a little later, but I think towards the end of the conclave, we could connect with them and take your questions forward. That was a good start, ladies and gentlemen, an interesting expert debate indeed, and we will be moving forward to our next panel discussion. I would also request everyone to come forward for a group photograph, please. Request all the panelists to come forward for a group photograph. So thank you so much. Thank you once again.